Father, we thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit here. Lord, we love your presence. We thank you, Lord God, that you dwell in our hearts. And Lord, you let us feel your presence. We're grateful for that. And Lord, let your presence, Lord, reproduce joy in our hearts today, Lord. Your word says, in your presence, there's fullness of joy. Fill us with that joy today, we pray, in Jesus' name. And everyone said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. You may be seated. Come on up here. How's everybody doing? How are you doing? How are you doing? Got to get a handshake in there? Okay. Tell me what was special about this past week in school. Does anyone remember? Did anyone get any candy this week with special hearts? What do we call that? How many like Valentine's Day? All right. Now, why do you like Valentine's Day? Yes. Hold on. One at a time. Hold on. Because of what? Because you know who likes you. And who loves you. Someone else. What's another reason? Come on, guys. We're only in it for the food, right? All right. Well, you can't go through Valentine's Day without talking about how much our God loves us, right? And if God has a Valentine's, it's all of us. How many heard of that scripture, for God so loved the world? He loves you so much, and he proved it by sending his son. That's right. So say this with me, all right? Say, I am loved by God. I am God's Valentine. I am God's Valentine. So, my wife, who's not here today, she says we've got to give the kids a Valentine from God. How many want a Valentine from God? No, you can't. That's a typical man's response right there. So, Pastor Roger's going to bring me down the Valentines. And I tell you what we're going to do, Tim. There's a scripture that says you have not because you ask not. So it's important that we ask. I'm not going to give you 10. But since I have a lot, I'm going to let everyone have 2. Would you like that? All right. Now, I'm going to start with the ladies first, okay? You can take 2 if you would like. All right. And the only thing I ask you is that you don't eat the candy until after church, all right? Don't eat the candy till after church. So if your teachers catch you, I'm going to come back to the guys in just a second. You get 2? You want 2? Okay. The teachers can say, don't eat it. Okay, now the boys, take 2, please. They're all the same. There you go. Pastor better start praying that it multiplies. All right, get 2? There we go. If you don't want to, you don't have to have 2. Who am I missing? Right down here, right? Sure. There you go. You want 2? You want 2? Yeah. We got more. Here, you just take them and give them if you would. Okay. So there's 1 left so Pastor can read the Valentines from God, okay? This is what it says. This is how much God loves you. In Isaiah 49:16, it says, I have engraved you on the palm of my hand. Isn't that wonderful? I have engraved you on the palm of my hand. So who'd like Elizabeth? Would you help the pastor today say the scripture? Why don't you come up here? Say it nice and loud.
No.
Let's say it together.
Faith is the substance.
substance for things hoped for, and evidence of things not seen. Where is it written?
Hebrews 11:1.
Where is it written?
Hebrews 11:1.
Okay. Now remember, guys and girls, I gave you these gifts because God loves you. The pastor loves you. But don't play with them and distract the teachers while they teach today, okay? Put the pastor in the doghouse. And there's a good thing what we can do. We're going to ask you when you be seated to give all these gifts to your parents and leave them with your parents. And then when you go to children's church, your teachers can have your attention, okay? All right, let's pray. Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Father, may this small token of love go into their hearts that they would always know that they are loved by you, Lord. Father, may we never doubt your love for us. We ask this in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Okay, boys and girls, you may be seated, and you please give those Valentine's gifts to your parents. There's one left for you, buddy. How's that, huh? Today is Mission Sunday, and so we're going to ask Vinny if you would shut off the lights in the back, and we're going to show you a little video on missions before we receive our morning tithes and offerings.
My name's Helena. I'm from Toronto, Canada, and I'm from YWAM Biarritz in France. We have been operating on Next Wave, which is a YWAM ship, and it is kind of serving as our mobile base on Lesbos. So we were able to bring it here, and we actually house a lot of our volunteers on the ship. I help coordinate the teams into the camp and finding accommodation and doing the kind of detail work to actually get them inside the camp. Something that God has been showing me here as a coordinating is that there are a lot of different roles and of the body of Christ. So this crisis in general and what God is doing is for the entire body. It's for all of the body of Christ to answer. So he's shown me with my organizational skill and just kind of getting things done orderly. I really like lists that he's really able to use me through this crisis. And get involved, because I think, you know, coming from Canada and thinking about people back home, it's so easy to watch from a distance, and it's even easier to not watch at all. But to, you know, remember that we live in the same world, and that this is still humanity, these are still people. This is such a time of opportunity, and I get reminded of the Bible verse that says, for such a time as this that you are called, that we have this opportunity to share with these people who are coming out of a place where they've never been allowed to hear the story of Jesus as Savior before, are able to come into a place where we can freely share with them, and it's such an honor. It's really our responsibility to be aware of what's going on and to remain involved, even if it is at a distance, because we really need all the help that we can get.
Praise God. Let's continue to pray for our missionaries abroad. And this is YWAM's Lisa Bracco, who is one of our church members. She's with this organization. And let's pray that as they spread the word in every way throughout the world, that we are part of it. Amen. So as we give our tithes and offerings and as we give to the missionary fund, we help spread God's word. So let's do our best, church, to really, in these last days, let's do our best to take a part in any way that we can to spread his word, amen, and to reach out to people that are in need. And, you know, sometimes we have needs among ourselves, but there's a world out there full of people that are in chaos, people that are looking and searching for God. And let's support, let's pray for these organizations, let's support and pray for our missionaries, and let's do our best to spread his word, amen, as we give and as we donate. You know, we sometimes think it's just about paying the bills, paying the mortgage, paying for the lights, but it's for everything else, too, that needs to be done to spread the word, and that's what's important, amen? So we want to be part of that, and there's maybe you can't go to South Africa, maybe you can't go to Ireland, but we can give, and that helps as part of the helping these missionaries spread the word of God, amen? So as the ushers come this morning, the first baskets will be for the church offerings, and the second one will be a missionary offering, which we take once a month. Amen. Let's pray for the offering. Heavenly Father, this morning, once again, we come to you, and as we come to you in praise and in worship, we also come to you, Lord, with our offerings as we give unto you this morning. Lord, bless the missionary offering as it goes out, and it blesses those missionaries and those people that are out working for you, Lord. And we pray that you help us all to be a light and the salt of this earth with our offerings, with our praise, and with everything that we are. We pray this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Are you on? Can we have the musicians on?
Above all the earth.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, worship team, Sarah. And let's continue to pray for them, that God continues to bless them. Amen. I have a few announcements, but before we do that, I just want to welcome everyone in God's house this morning on behalf of the church. And any first-time visitors? First-time visitors? Just raise your hand. We just want to acknowledge that you're here. Okay, good. No first-time visitors. We have, okay. God bless you. Thank you for choosing our church. Amen. Is everybody happy this morning? It's Valentine's Day. The weather is getting warm. We should be happy. It's not Valentine's Day, is it? It's Valentine's month. Whatever, same thing. Should always be Valentine's Day in our hearts. Amen. But God is good. God is good. All right, I have just a couple announcements, and then we'll go on with the service. As you noticed, as you came in, the women are having a bake sale, so please pick something up on your way out. But Claire asked me to make two announcements, and the first announcement is for the ladies that are going to the retreat. There's a sign-up list in the back for those that want to go to the Eastern District Women's Retreat, March 24th and 25th. And the deadline is next Sunday, so please see Claire for more details, ladies. The second one is there's a donation box in the lobby. We're sending Claire to prison. She's been bad, so she's going to jail. But Claire is involved with the Kairos prison ministry, and there's a box in the back for donations, and there's also hands that she hands there. You could take that hand, and it's a prayer hand, but see Claire after the service. She'll give you all the information for that. Okay, and all the other announcements are posted, so let's continue to worship the Lord, to do what we need to do for his honor and glory, and let's be active, and let's participate as much as we can in worshiping, in serving, in being active in our church, and just working for his glory. Amen? All right, the kids can leave now, and everybody just greet one another for a couple seconds. And let's continue to praise the Lord. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. It's good to see everyone here in the house of the Lord. Last night we had I don't know what you call it, because it really wasn't a couples get together, but we had a Valentine celebration with singles and couples, and we had about 40 people, give or take, 40 people last night at Amalfi's, and it was wonderful. It was wonderful. So thank you for everyone that came out. What a great time. There's nothing like the fellowship of the body of Christ. Amen? Amen? I mean, some of us, we may be blessed to have good family. Some of us maybe not so blessed. But we can always be blessed with brothers and sisters in Christ. All right? Always be blessed with that. So thank you for coming out. My wife sends her greetings. She's still recuperating. She came out last night, but all the walking was very hard on her leg, and so she had little spasms going on. For some of you that don't know, she had recent surgery on her calf, so it's very hard for her to walk. But she sends her love and her greetings, and she appreciates your texts and your cards and your kind words. So thank you very much for that. How many enjoyed the snow day last Sunday? You say, well, Pastor, did you enjoy the snow day? Not really, because I still prepared. But a couple weeks ago, I began a sermon on integrity. It's entitled, One Word That Can Change Your Life. Now, if you're new here, I try to do little outlines. When you come in, you can always look on the back, and you can follow along if you like outlines. If you don't, that's okay. But I began, I'm going to finish it today, One Word That Can Change Your Life, and that is the word integrity. And if you have a Bible, you can turn to Psalms 25, verse 20. And how many were here a couple weeks ago when I spoke on integrity? Just put your hand up. All right. How many, when I spoke, God spoke to you through the Word of God? Put your hand up. Okay, take it down. How many of you, when I spoke, felt God gave you some direction about strengthening your integrity? Put your hand up. All right, put it down. Very good. Last one. How many of you have acted on what you felt God had impressed upon you to do since 2 weeks ago? Put your hand up. Good for you. Good for you. Amen. Amen. It's good that we obey the Lord. Obedience is one of the ways we release His faith in our lives. Amen. And we're grateful for that. So I want to talk to you about integrity. One word that will change your life. We sang these songs today about power in the blood, victory that we have. All these things we have as an inheritance in Jesus Christ. But how many of you know you can have an inheritance and not realize what you have? Maybe some of us came to Christ, and before we came to Jesus Christ, we had a hard time with honesty. We had a hard time with being truthful. And I want you to know that in Jesus Christ, that can all change. Amen? We can be people of our word. We can be people of integrity. And so let's look at Psalm. We'll start in verse 20. And it says, keep my soul and deliver me. Let me not be ashamed, for I put my trust in you. And then verse 21, let integrity and uprightness preserve me, for I wait for you. You want to live a life without shame? Ask God to grow integrity in our lives. Amen? Now, for some of you that may have not been here a few weeks ago, let me just do a little review of what we talked about. Integrity comes from a Greek word where we get in math, integer. And integer means whole numbers. Whole numbers. So to have integrity means to have a moral wholeness to you. Not a duplicity where we live one way and act another way. How many know what I'm saying? Some people, you know, they say one thing, but they do another thing. And that's duplicity. You know, it's like it's split. But integrity is when our heart is the same as what we say, all right? And this is biblical. Salvation comes this way. In Romans 10, it says that if you shall believe in your heart that God has raised Christ from the dead and confess what? With your mouth. You are not saved just because you go around and say in your heart, I believe there's a God. According to the Bible, your belief has to be matched with your words. All right? The confession of what people see has to be the same. Now, let me give you another scripture. It's in your bulletin. The next verse. Maybe we'll read this one together in Proverbs 10:9. And read this with me, would you? He who walks with integrity walks securely, but he who perverts his ways will become known. Proverbs 10:9. Now, this is important because in Christ Jesus,
Whether we had integrity before him or not, we can be people of integrity. He wants us to be people of integrity. Very important. Now, here, the wisest person that ever lived, Solomon, he says, listen, if you don't live with integrity, you're going to pervert your way. And one of the things that we don't realize is that the first time we begin to disobey God, do something that we know we shouldn't do, walk in sin, how many know God doesn't just show up and hit you the first time? And guess what? The devil is too smart to expose you the first time. See, the devil's not going to expose the skeletons in your closet until he knows he can do the most damage to your testimony, to your marriage, to your children, to your church. So he waits. And yet the self-deception is, I got away with it. I got away with it. And that's the perversion that deceives us. It deceives us. And so we want to walk securely, amen? And you might remember the first thing I said is, relationships are impossible without integrity. You know, relationships are hard enough, but they're impossible. You'll never have a good marriage without integrity. You'll never be a good father, a mother without integrity. You never develop good friends in this world without integrity. You can be a person of your word. You can't be one thing when no one's looking and another thing in public. It will catch up to you. And remember I said the answer is not as a follower of Jesus Christ, oh, I'll just try harder. It's not about trying harder. It's about letting the life of Christ in you flow through grace to transform you. Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. It's not trying harder as a Christian. It's letting the life of Christ come through you. Amen? Amen. So I said, listen, relationships are impossible without integrity. I'm not even going to talk about your relationship with your kids, relationship with your spouse. It starts with your relationship with God. All right? That's the most important. And so God says, listen, Christianity is not a smorgasbord where you just come and you just do this and you say, well, I like this. Well, I don't like that. Well, I like this. It doesn't work like that. And so there's a scripture in your outline, John 4:24, and Jesus is saying, listen, I'm going to tell you about my Father. There's some things that my Father has integrity, and he won't compromise on this. All right? So he says this, God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now you say, what is that? Well, truth is what comes out of your heart. All right? In fact, David said in Psalm 51:6, he says, you desire truth in the most what? Anyone know it? Inward parts. All right? So again, God's saying, listen, I want you to have a heart that matches up with your lifestyle. I don't want a difference in private than in public. Very important that we understand that. Another one in Psalms 145, 18, it says, the Lord listens to all those who call upon him in what? Truth. So truth is important for us Christians, all right? You know, maybe you grew up and you had a problem telling lies. Well, when you come to Christ, you got to start telling the truth. And it's not about trying. It's about letting the Spirit of truth work through you, amen? But then there's another relationship that sometimes is harder than our relationship with God. And that's our relationship with ourselves. And there can come a self-deception in our lives if we're not careful. Very dangerous. And so we have to be truthful to ourselves. We got to make sure, and I talked a little bit about this, we're not going to go through Psalm 15, but I said it's so important that we don't deceive ourselves because we can do that. Now let me tell you, 1 John, I'm going to quote some scriptures to you, okay? 1 John 1, I think if you want to find it, verse 3 or 4. The Apostle John says this to the Christians that are starting to deceive themselves because they're acting one way in the church and another way at home. So he says this. These things we write unto you that your joy might be full. How many want more joy in their life?
How many want a fullness of joy? Listen, he says, the things which we have heard from him, from Christ, we now declare to you. And this is the message, you probably heard this, that God is light, in him there is no what? Darkness. All right, here's how integrity flows. God is light, in him, no darkness. If we say we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, we lie and do not practice truth. So if we say, oh, I'm saved, but we live opposite to the book, we begin to lie because what we're saying with this is not matching up with this. All right? Next verse, verse 7. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses us from what? All sin. If you walk in the light with your words and your heart, if they're the same, integrity, you can have better friendships with people in the church that are also people of integrity. Now let me tell you something. Not everyone in church are people of integrity. You got to find those that really love the Lord. And you say, well, maybe they shouldn't be here. No, no. The best place for hypocrites is in the church. Where else is there help? This is not a church for the perfect. This is a church of grace and mercy. All right? If we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Christ cleanses us from all sin. Next verse. But if we say we have no sin, next verse. But if we say we have no sin, we start believing our lies and we deceive ourselves. It is so easy to deceive yourself. Do you know that? It starts by just telling lies, and then it continues by believing our lies. How many of you ever grew up and found some people that just liked to lie when you were younger? How many of you knew a few compulsive liars? They just said, they're out in la-la land. And yet they believed their lies. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Oh, but I'm saved. I'm saved, brother. Praise the Lord, I'm saved. No? Verse 9, but if we confess our sin, he is faithful. What do we confess with? But if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all what? Where does the righteousness come from? With the heart, man believes unto righteousness. And with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Do you see how God works this so that the cleansing for our hearts always comes through our conversation and our repentance? But then there's a danger in self-deception. I'm talking to someone. First we tell lies, then we begin to deceive ourselves by believing our lies, and then the last part that you're in a lot of trouble is you start telling lies about God, which is verse 10. If we say we have no sin, I'm not a sinner, don't tell me I'm a sinner. All right, you're not only telling lies, you're not only believing your lies, but now you're saying God is a liar. You make him a liar. And his word is not in us. That's the total self-deception of people who believe they're going to heaven because they say, I believe in God, but their conversation doesn't match what's in their heart. How many follow me? We can be people of integrity. Jesus has provided for us to live in integrity. That which is in our heart, not perfection, all right, but a desire to grow in integrity and grace and mercy, amen. Number two, this one's important to me. Peace is impossible without integrity. I don't know about you, but peace is important to me. Some of you have some good jobs, and some of you have some very stressful jobs. And those of you that are very stressed, you understand peace. And you understand what it means to fight and get peace, and then you understand how to fight to keep the peace. Parents know that, right? My mother, she was so funny when, you know, she had four boys and one girl, and we used to start fighting. She'd get so mad, she'd say, fight, fight, I hate peace, just fight. And we'd all stop and look at her like, uh-oh, what happened to Mom? But it worked. We all stopped. Peace is important. Now, let me tell you something. There's two types of peace. There's peace with God, and then there's a peace of God. Two types of peace we need in our lives. Peace with God, Romans 5:1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. That's where we begin to live for Jesus Christ. That's peace with God. But just because you get saved doesn't mean you have the peace of God on your life. The next one is when you start letting what you believe in here match up by what you're saying here. That's when the peace of God comes on your life. Philippians 4, 6, and 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God, and the peace of that passeth all understanding shall keep your and mine through him. Isn't that beautiful? You want some peace? Stop worrying and start praying. All right? Worry is faith in the devil. Prayer is faith in God. All right? But there's another verse in your text, in your outline, that tells us how to have the peace of God other than just prayer. Let's look at that. This one's a little more difficult. Next verse. Bearing one another, forgiving one another, but above all, put on love, which is the bond of perfection, and let the peace of who? The peace of God rule where? You see, if you want peace of God, it starts here. All right? And how many know, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks? So if you have peace here, you can speak peace into stressful situations at work. Amen? You can do that. You'd be surprised what we can do with the authority of Christ. But the way to keep the peace, we have to put up with one another. We got to bear with one another, all our shortcomings. And then number two, we got to forgive one another, which means someone's going to dish you, stab you in the back, say things, and God says you want to keep peace? Forgive them. Forgive them. But God, they're going to get away with it. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. All right? Forgive them. All right? Put on love, which is the bond of perfection. Let the peace of God. All right? So you got to have a good attitude against those who hurt you. You got to forgive. You got to be willing to forgive. You got to walk in humility. And so there's people in this church, there's singles in this church. Maybe there's some married couples in this church, and they're a little frustrated with their relationship because they don't feel like there's any peace in their marriage. And maybe there's some women that say, I didn't sign up for this. This is not what I want. And you say, I just want a husband who would just kind of open his heart and be intimate. And then you got some husbands that maybe they're hurt. They're hurt in the relationship. And instead of dealing with the hurt, they put all their time into work. They put all their time into sports or worse things. And so the wife says, well, I'm not going to give him any affection until he apologizes. And then he digs in and it's like, wait a minute. What about bearing with one another? How about forgiving one another? Romans 5:8, God demonstrated his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still away from him, rebellious, living our way, Jesus still loved us, didn't he? Listen to me, husbands, wives, singles, listen to me. Because when you're there and you're getting mad at your spouse, you're starting to tamper with the peace of God. Once you get the peace, you got to fight for the peace. And there's positive ways you can do that. You know, so many times there's just women and they're in bed and they're mad and they got their hands like this and they're like, I didn't sign up for this. I wanted a man that would take the lead. They usually think two things. I wanted a man that would be a spiritual leader. And then the second thing they say is, when's he going to stop snoring? See it if you're listening. We fight for peace, and once we get peace, we fight from peace. The Bible says, put on the shoes of the gospel of what? Peace. Let me tell you a story about my wife and I. Anytime I tell stories about my wife and I and our shortcomings, I always ask my wife permission. And we have a rule that if I ever tell a story that puts her in a negative light without her permission, I owe her $50. All right? So if I'm ever preaching and you see my wife come up and come down and go like this, that means I'm in trouble. But sometimes the story's worth $50. So I just got okay. So, but this one I asked permission for, okay? So years back, in our first year of marriage, we moved out to Springfield, Missouri, and we got married, and we moved 14 hours away from her parents, 16 hours away from my parents. We left mom and dad, and we cleaved to one another. It was hard. So one of our parents were coming out, and my wife, she has a gift of hospitality, and she works very hard to clean the house, to make the beds, and to make a great meal. And sometimes it stresses me how she goes out of her way for people. Because I'm like, if they don't like us the way we are, you know, why should we bend over? But my wife is different. God has given her different gifts. So she was stressing me the last couple days, cleaning the apartment and this and that. And I came home, had a stressful day at school. I don't know what happened. And so we sat down, we started eating, and she started saying things that started irritating me. And we were having soup and something and Ritz crackers. And I got mad. And I took the Ritz crackers, and I, after she cleaned the apartment, and I chucked them, and I hit the kitchen cabinets. And boom, it exploded. Some people are screamers, some people are throwers. Now, my wife says, "What's today, honey?" "Today's Tuesday." "Well, I thought Tuesday was Taco Tuesday. I didn't know it was Throwback Thursday." "But if you wanted to Throwback Thursday, I can abide." And so she went in there and she grabbed my favorite fruit, Chiquita bananas. She says, "Let's have a little party." Starts throwing them. She says, "Why don't we dance a little bit?" Starts dancing on the things. And I thought, oh boy, I started it. How am I going to finish this? Now, my wife gets angry this close before she cries. All right? And so it's very hard for me to discern how close I am to pushing her over the edge. Obviously, I pushed her over the edge. And so it was cold on the couch that night. Electric blanket wasn't working. So anyways, I cleaned the kitchen, cleaned the house. And I didn't do a good job keeping the peace of God. Now, people identify more with your failures than they ever will your successes. And there is a scripture I have for you people in relationships. You want to know how to handle stress in a relationship? There's a great verse. I wish I memorized it back then. It would have helped me. It's from Isaiah. It's in your outline. Isaiah 26. Verses 3 and 4, and it says this, King James here, "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusts in thee. Trust ye in the Lord Jehovah, for in the Lord is everlasting strength." You want more strength in your life? Strength comes from peace. You want more peace of God in your life? Peace comes from focusing on God. "Thou wilt keep him in perfect peace." Do you know what the Hebrew is? They didn't know how to. The Hebrew for peace is shalom. So the Hebrew phrase there is, "Thou wilt keep him in shalom, shalom, whose mind is stayed on thee." One of the ways to keep the peace of God in your life is to keep your mind on God. That's biblical, right? Solomon said, "He, as a man thinketh, so is he." Someone else said, "What happens in the mind happens in time." That's a good saying. That will tweet right there. What you keep focused in your mind eventually comes out of you. All right? I was stressed the last couple of days because I didn't deal with it right with my wife. But if I would have maybe focused on reading more of the Bible in my stress, quoting Scripture, praying, meditating on Scripture, it can help keep the peace. Peace is impossible without integrity. And then number three, and I end with this. Relationships are impossible. Peace is impossible. And number three is impact. Impact in life is impossible without integrity. Now, Jesus Christ said to his disciples, the word of God, you throw it out and you sow it, and it finds lodging places in people's hearts. But not everyone will respond to the word of God the same. Sometimes the seed produces 30-fold. How many know what I'm talking about? Sometimes it produces what? 60? And then with some people, 100-fold. 100-fold. Now those of us who want an impact in this world for 100-fold fruit for God have to be careful that we don't judge those who are 30 and 60. We just have to be grateful fruit is being born. All right? I want to have an impact in my generation. As it says in the book of Acts, it says that David served his generation. He served the purpose of his generation. That's what I want to do. But I can't do that, and you can't do that, without this thing called integrity. Listen to me. You are the only Christian some people will ever see in this world. And when they start going through some painful seasons, when they have a death of a child, a death of a baby, when they have a death of a marriage, when they have a death of a career, when they have a death of finances, when they lose things and they're in pain, you heard that commercial, Got Milk? Some people say, you got life? They're looking for life. And if you are the only person they see as a Christian, if we are people of integrity, they're going to say, oh, I guess Christianity isn't it. I'll go look elsewhere. And it doesn't mean we have to be perfect. It just means we can't pervert our ways. Look at the scripture. It says under number three, like a trampled spring or a polluted well, so is a righteous man or woman who gives way before the wicked. You don't have to do that, though. We don't have to give way. But sometimes we do. But God help us. People want to see Christians who are just honest. Christians that can share their weaknesses. That can tell a funny story of a failure in their marriage. They're looking for people that are not perfect. They're looking for people that know how to say, I'm sorry, honey, I was wrong. And then, what can I do to make it right? It's not about perfection. This church in the United States have gotten so much false teaching on legalism and perfection that it just robs us of joy. It robs us of love. And it robs some of us the strength to say, why even bother? Let's just stop. But that's not what the message of Christ is all about. He said that before you were born, Ephesians 2:10, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Before you were even born, he knew you would live, and he had a purpose for you to fulfill in this life and make an impact. And if you would say, God, help me to preserve the integrity you want me to be, you'll make an impact. You'll make an impact. Now, let's be honest. We all fib sometimes. We all exaggerate the truth a little bit. We all have to say we're not as close to our Heavenly Father that we would like to be. But a way to begin to have a little more joy in our life, this is the message we write to you, that your joy might be full, 1 John 4:1-4. Is just to take the mask off. Just to begin to just take the mask off and say, listen, I'm not perfect. And when we do that, the Bible says that's when grace begins to flow. Next verse. When you humble yourself and let people just see you that, hey, I'm not perfect. Look what the next verse says. James 4:6, please. But he gives more grace. He gives grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace to what? The humble. He gives grace to the humble. When we begin to take our masks off, he gives us grace. Isn't that wonderful? It's about humility. Can I tell you what humility is? Humility is simple honesty with God. I'm nothing without you, God. Jesus, when you said, without me, you can do nothing, I believe you. I have a lot of shortcomings, Lord. I always try to put my best foot forward, but sometimes I trip over that foot. And God says, that's all right. God is not in heaven as a judge looking for you to step out of line so he can expose you. That's not our Father. That's not Jesus Christ. But he's a God of mercy. He is the prodigal son's father. Remember the story of the prodigal son? And every day the father would look up, waiting for his son to come back to embrace him with open arms. That's our Heavenly Father. That even when we mess up big. If we would just be honest, not lie, we'd be honest at work. You know, you don't got the report in. You don't say, oh, my dog ate it or something else. But you say, listen, I blew it. I'm sorry. I've had some stressful things happening at house, and I'm late, and I'm sorry. You just tell the truth. You might be surprised. Even your unsaved boss, God may move through him to show you mercy. It might be a witness of our honesty. Jesus wants to change us from the inside out. So let's ask ourselves, what is it in our lives that maybe is a little short with our integrity? Is that maybe our thought life, maybe fantasies, maybe finances, maybe a relationship, maybe something at work? The Bible says in 1 John 1:9, but if we would confess our sin, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. How many know if he's cleansed you from all unrighteousness, you have the peace of God on you? And if you have the peace of God on you, you can bring that peace wherever you are. And you can release that peace. In Jesus' name, I release the peace of God in this place. I release that which is in my heart with a confession and a prayer out of my mouth. Let it be in this classroom. Let it be at work. Let it be in this home. Let it be in my relationship. Amen. Amen. Bow your heads. The Bible promises us if we would just confess to the Lord, that means just to agree with God, be honest. It says that he will forgive us and cleanse us. And I want you to know if you come to a father who says, I understand. He says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He's not looking for you to do 9 good deeds to make up for the one that you messed up on. But if you would humble yourself and come to him, he would give you mercy and grace. Amen. Amen. Father, we come to you and we ask for your mercy and grace. We want to be people of integrity, that we would show forth your truth, your peace, your love. We want to walk securely, Lord. What a promise. We understand, Lord, that when we pervert our way, the day will come that we will be exposed. We don't want that, Lord. We want to make it right. Would you take this truth that we heard from your word today, ingrain it into our hearts? Lord, help us not to deceive ourselves with the little lies, the false motives. But Lord, help us not to be condemned either. But Lord, help us to realize when there's a pattern of shortcomings, Lord, to come to you. Ask you, Lord, for more strength. Ask you for more of the life of Christ to flow through us. That the cross of Jesus Christ would cut out of our life that which is not pleasing and replace it with more mercy and grace. Lord, we need more freedom in our life. We want to experience your freedom. You promised, Lord, we'd know the truth. In John 8, you said we would know the truth and the truth would make us free. And I pray for that grace and liberty to be in our lives today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Integrity is something that God wants to grow in our hearts. And I believe that there are some of us that need to come down to the altar today and just set some things right with God. Maybe it's a relationship. I said integrity is impossible, or relationships are impossible without it. Maybe there's a relationship that you need to come down here and just lay on the altar and say, Lord, I can't carry this anymore. I need, God, it's just overwhelming. If you would come down, and the Bible says, if you would humble yourself, it says he gives grace. He gives grace. But it's not enough to believe it. You got to come humble yourself and confess it. Maybe for some of us, it's not about a relationship. Maybe it's peace. Maybe there's just so much striving in our life, striving with a relationship, striving with kids, striving at work. Whatever it is, the Bible says, if you would come down here and say, God, I'm tired of striving. I want the peace of God. Lord, I have peace with you, but I want the peace of God. I believe you take a step forward, he would answer that prayer. And then lastly, there's some of you young people saying, I don't know what to do with my life, but I do want to do something for the Lord. I want to do something. I want to have an impact. That was my desire when I was a late teen. I want to do something. Well, it starts just by letting truth be in our inner parts. Say, oh God, make me a man of truth. Make me a person of my word, Lord God. And I'm just going to invite you to come and find a spot. I'm going to ask the musicians to come if they would and just play softly. But if God has been speaking to you today, would you just come down here just as between you and the Lord? You can find a spot around the altar here, and whatever it is, the Bible says, call unto me, and I will answer you, and I will show you great mighty things. You may come down here, and God may give you a directive. He may impress on you to do something, to maybe break free this thing that's harassing you. Come down and find a place. It's a good time to renew our relationship with God and have his peace. Amen. Amen. As they're playing, would you just be in an attitude of prayer? Pray that God would speak and move and restore to those that are down here. This is just between you and God. You can find a spot around the altars, or you can be on the front pews. But Lord, let your spirit of truth be ingrained in my heart. Amen. Amen. Let's just take a few minutes. You may be seated if you'd like, just to be in an attitude of prayer. But would you just pray for those that are up here that God would speak to them.
Father, we thank you for your word today. You said, Lord, if we were your disciples, we would abide in your word. And we would know the truth. And the truth would make us free. I thank you, Lord God, for establishing more integrity in our lives today. Thank you, Lord, that the Spirit of truth has conformed us to the image of Jesus Christ a little more today. I thank you, Lord, that we have believed what a merciful and gracious Father you are a little more today. Now, Father, I pray your peace upon us, that it would strengthen us for all that we need to do this week in every endeavor. Don't let fear rob us of your peace, Lord. But Lord, let your faith be strong, the shield of faith, to stop every fiery dart that would try to rob us of something this week. We thank you for your peace and your faith. In Jesus' name, amen. And would you stand with me and would you say this verse together? A good confession. You say, Pastor, I have a problem with fear. Well, start confessing some scriptures with your mouth so that they can get down in your heart. Amen? Sometimes it comes out of our heart. Sometimes we need to put things in our heart. And this was a great scripture that God said to Joshua. Let's say it together. Be strong and of a good courage. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Joshua 1:9. Amen. God bless you. Go in his peace today. There are some goodies in the back. They are selling a bake sale in the back, so make sure you pick some up. Greet about 5 people before you go. Go in his peace.